Hello, this is Dr. Lindsay. And in this video, what we're going to be going through is the unemployment data, which is very important in macroeconomics. So we're going to go through who produces this data and how do you get access to it and what's it contain? And then what is their methodology for creating this data? What's the process they go through to come up with their numbers? What do they mean? Well, it's a Department of Labor, Bureau of Labor Statistics, that is responsible for collecting this data and reporting it. They have something called the Current Population Survey. Current Population Survey. And it actually is a survey of people. They do to come up with these numbers. And you can go out and see what the current information is on unemployment by going to their website, which is bls.gov/CPS to find out what the current unemployment rate is. Now I'm going to show you what you'll see, but I took a snapshot of it in August 2020, right after the recession, the unemployment rate was coming down. I would have preferred to get a snapshot a little few months earlier, but I forgot. So let me show you this one that I clicked on last August 2020. Okay, so here it is, August 2020, CPS. And if you go out to their website right now, you'll see something kind of like this. It'll be the latest numbers. But what I want you to look at the most is up here in the corner, the latest numbers. And the unemployment rate, it says there, is 8.4% in August 2020. It's reported like that as a percentage. So August 2020, it was 8.4%. What's our methodology for coming up with that number? Well, it's by survey. They go out and actually talk to people. It's not done by looking at the unemployment claims that people were making to collect unemployment when they lose their job. It's different. They actually go out and talk to people. So the first question is, they ask, are you working? Yes or no? If you say yes, you are employed. If you say no, they ask another question. Are you looking for a job? If you say yes, you are considered unemployed. If you say no, you are considered out of the labor force. So these two questions here will help you answer almost any kind of question, at least 90% of the questions, to try to figure out if the person's employed or unemployed or out of the labor force. There may be some gray areas, you know, you can't quite figure out. In that case, you can always call them and ask them. Like, well, what category do students fall in? You can give them a call and ask them and they'll talk to you about it. I've done that. So let's go through a few examples here. Now we know that if you say no to both, you're out of the labor force. That means that these two categories here, employed and underemployed or unemployed, would be the labor force. Yep. So this is the labor force right here. The number of people employed plus the number of people unemployed. So let's go through a few examples here to let you identify certain situations and what category they're going to be included in. So how about retired people? What category? Well, retired person, if they don't have a job and they're not looking for a job, then they're going to be out of the labor force. What about a stay-home husband? Doesn't have a job, isn't looking for a job, out of the labor force. What about a part-time worker? Well, the first question is, do you have a job? Yes, employed. Don't need to go any further. What about discouraged workers? Now, this is a special category. It refers to a certain category of people. Discouraged workers. These are people who are out of a job and they've been looking for a job for a while and they can't find one. And they finally give up looking because there are just no jobs available. Maybe there's a recession or depression going on and they can't find it. So they actually just give up looking for a while. Maybe if they're old enough, they'll collect Social Security or live off their trust fund or grab a backpack and go to South America for a year or move in with their parents or a girlfriend, something like that. What category do they fit in? Out of the labor force. Not unemployed. And when they're asking these questions, are you looking for a job? They give them some amount of time. It's like, I think it's like 4 weeks. So they say, have you looked for a job in the last 4 weeks? You say, no, 3 months ago I was looking for a job, but not anymore. Okay, the answer is no. What about underemployed workers? So underemployed people are someone that's working in a job lower than their skill level for whatever reason. So maybe there is a aerospace engineer working for Boeing, making a good salary, and they get laid off. And there's no other aircraft manufacturers in Seattle. And the other aircraft manufacturers around aren't hiring anybody because there's a downturn in the economy and they're not selling any airplanes. They can't find another job in their field. They don't want to stop bringing in some money. So they take another job, whatever it is. Maybe it's delivering pizzas. Okay, so we have this unemployed aerospace engineer delivering pizzas. And if you talk to them, say, are you working? Yes. So they're employed. Even if it's way below their skills and abilities. Now, these numbers that are produced, it's a percentage that we're looking at. So we end up with some number that's like 5% or 8.4% or 10%, something like that. And it is the number unemployed divided by the labor force. That percentage there gives us the number of unemployed, the unemployment rate in the economy. And remember, the labor force is employed plus unemployed. So when they publish this data, they also include a few other things. They'll ask them a few more questions. Like, what is your education? What is your age? Gender, race. So if you want to get their data for some sort of study, you can go out to their website and find out this kind of thing. You want to find out that college degreed people of certain ages are paying more or unemployed more than people without a college degree of different age categories. You can get that kind of information. Now, as I said, the information they get is by survey. And I often wondered, like, well, how, if they go out to people's homes and start conducting these surveys, aren't you just going to get a bunch of unemployed people and retired people? How are you going to get an accurate number for the employed? Well, I talked to them. I gave them a call to find out this kind of information. I said, how do you do this kind of survey? And first of all, they don't have to ask too many people. If you do a good designed survey sample, you can get the information you need without asking a whole lot of people. So for example, say you have this barrel, trash barrel full of ping pong balls. Some of them are red, some of them are blue. And you don't know the percentages of how many are red and how many are blue. Well, what you can do is you can reach into the trash barrel with your eyes closed and pick out, say, 30 or 40 of them. And you don't want to pick them all from the same place. You want them from all sorts of different places around the trash can and pull them up, you know, randomly selected. And then look at what you've picked. Pick them with your blindfold on and then take off the blindfold to look at this 30 or 40 balls. And you can measure the percentage of blue ones in that sample. And with a pretty high degree of confidence, you can know that it's going to be similar or close to what's in the trash can barrel. So that's what they do. They just have a very well-designed survey randomly of people around the country to go talk to. And then they can look at that sample that they have of employed and unemployed, and they know that that will pretty much be with a high rate of confidence close to what's actually going on in the economy. Now, when they're doing this kind of thing, they're asking only people that are not in the military. They only talk to people that are over 16. They don't talk to people that are in institutions like jail or a nursing home. And what they told me, what they do is they have this, they have the list of who to contact, and it's by address. They don't care who's living there. They just want to know that they want to know who is living at that particular address at that time, and then go talk to them. So their first contact is by mail, and they tell them how this important this data is and get them to return the survey. If they don't return the survey, then they'll send somebody out to their house to try to talk to them, their residents, and keep after them until they get that information. If they move away, they don't follow them. They just want the people at that address. So somebody else moves in, then they keep asking the people at that address. They follow them for about 2 months. So there's a little bit of overlap in the data. So about half the people are asking, they've already asked the previous month, half of them are new people, and they'll follow them for a couple of months to smooth out the data a little bit on their collection information. So this data comes out every single month, not too long after the month is over, and gives a good picture of what's going on in the economy.